I do not think it is very considerate, Arthur. It seems quite obvious to me that running from London to Brussels served one purpose, to get away from you. And what do? You follow me. Why?
Because I love you, Paul.
Bullshit! Is it the money? Because I must say, in that case, you never had much of a business mind. You could have found a far richer man or woman in England. Your pupils certainly seem to appreciate your charm.
You came because I could not do otherwise. I had to follow you. You know what it's like, Paul. We cannot live without each other.
Can't we?
You know it. I was a boy. You took me and you opened my eyes and showed me the wall. I'm begging you, Paul. Think about it.
I'm thinking hard. To join our household. I say, young poet, he is but a boy, scarcely out of school. He's very clever, he's won a great deal of school prizes, and right now he's wasting his talent in some hole near the Belgian border called Charleville.
Excuse me, but what is this talent of which you speak? Are you thinking I should employ this young poet in my company? Give him some cloth for it.
I'm afraid. The talent of which I speak is of a different nature. The boy writes. He has written some of the most beautiful poems I've ever read. And I feel, without wishing to elevate my merit,
that wouldn't be difficult.
I could help him find his voice.
But why on earth would we want to adopt another poet? I mean, it's not like we don't have one already.
Because there will come a day where everyone will know the name Arthur Rimbaud.
I am fond of you, Verlaine. You've always treated my daughter and our family with the utmost respect. No mean feat for an artist. Say what you will in their defence, but they have their flaws, whatever their noble pursuit. But this matter requires some thought. Meet me in my office tomorrow, after breakfast, for my final answer.
Next thing you know, we'll be starting a home for stray poets. Wait until I tell Madame Dupuis!
My darling, what if my father says no?
He doesn't have much of a choice, really. I've already sent Arthur one-way tickets to Paris.
Well, in that case, the only option you have left is elopement.
Dear master, do you cringe? A little obsequiousness can't hurt, dear master. You do not know how great an honour you bestow upon me. You have descended into my life like divine grace, and lifting me out of this dire mire, raised me to the light of culture, of art. What am I even saying? I apologise, my great excitement debases my prose. But you must know, it has always been my most burning desire to travel to Paris and there test my rough-hewn talent. Just as I was about to give in, after so much rejection, you have provided the kindling to my spark, the air to feed what I hope will become, if not a shining beacon, then at least a torch, the brightly burning flame of my muse, which would only be stifled were I to remain here in
fucking sure of you. I will arrive on Monday by the 3 o'clock train, an ignoble carriage for so marvellous a voyage. My God, they'll think me a child. But what else can I say? It is deliverance.
Arthur, are you coming down for supper?
No, mother. I won't eat your foul burned offerings tonight or any other night. I'm going to Paris to be a poet. I won't eat shitty cassoulet or drink horse-piss beer like a peasant. I'll dine on rarer meats, fine wines, truffles, champagne, or live on nothing but art and strong tobacco.
Get going, Arthur!
What is it?
Sausages and boiled sprouts. Hurry, or get going!
Shove your sprouts up your arse, mother. I'm leaving! Joy. The future glistens like a ripe plum, ready to be picked. In poetic brotherhood, Arthur Rimbaud. Fuck you, mother! Fuck you, Baccalaureo! Fuck you, Charlevoix! I am done with childish things! This is Monsieur Paul Verlaine's house.
Well, actually...
Oh, ladies, it was a typical bull. A typical bull.
I cannot remember if the garden or the garden is.
And so, we run between them, to and fro. It was such a typical bull.
Well, Monsieur, it is a pleasure to meet you. I can't thank you enough for your generosity and your hospitality.
Well, actually...
Madame Hôtel, I was wondering, could you be so kind as to show me that exquisite cabinet of yours? I'm thinking of writing a poem about it.
Well, Charles, I think it's in Mathilde's room now, but we would be delighted to give you a tour of the house.
Yes, and then I might have a little rest.
Oh, it's excellent. Come. Nobody wants to see my cabinets these days.
You're so ugly.
What?
Your face, I've never seen anything quite like it.
Well then, you can't have seen much. Paris holds far rarer grotesques. You'll soon come to find me commonplace.
Oh, the grotesques of Paris, like in Baudelaire's The Seven Old Men. How upset I was every time I came to Paris, knowing that I could not stay. But now it's become my home, my city. Will I love my time in Paris? Or will I die in its artificial hell of steel, like in the swan? Monsieur Verlaine, thank you. I think I'm here not just as a spectator of the Parisian tableau, but as an actor and a painter.
You're an admirer of Baudelaire.
Oh, he is the king of poets.
But you speak of Parisian poems, which means you're familiar with the second edition of the Flowers of Evil, not the original. The censored pieces are among the most beautiful. Here, take a look.
These are beautiful. This is like nothing else. Thank you.
You're so ugly.
So you mentioned, and it's no less pleasant the second time.
I apologize. I am crude and crass and raw. I need a guide. Will you be my Virgil? Guide me through the dark bounds of this new inferno. Will you teach me how to live poetry? Not just on paper, but with every drop of blood that beats through my heart. Monsieur Verlaine, my future, I am putting it in your hands.
You barely know me. Do you know what you're asking?
Maybe I don't, but you can show me. I want to know.
I will, if that's what you want, I promise, but I come to think I will regret it all too soon.
I do pass to sing together the glorious anthem of the crowd.
Woo!
aside from our friend,
Why, yes, which poets? Do tell.
With that haircut, I am willing to bet that you are a young romantic.
You must love me, sir.
Why, yes, you must!
Not really.
Why not?
He's far too provincial for my taste. All this sickening charm and greenery. There's nothing of Paris in his works. The man is truly out of touch with what matters to us.
Us?
Our generation. The hesitation and laziness that holds us back from any real commitment. Our unfulfilled religious and philosophical pretensions. And our yawning apathy to the arguments of our fathers. And our powerful but vague emotions. All of these are mingling together with the primal instinct for rebirth. Which makes me wonder, as this pointless century draws to a close, what next? As for poetry, I'm a great fan of Baudelaire.
Well, well, well.
And what is your opinion of Mr. Baudelaire?
He was a visionary, our true spiritual leader, but he did not go far enough.
What might you possibly mean by that?
More than anyone else, Baudelaire pushed past the boundaries of the past, defined the risks of stagnancy and respectability. But the future of poetry demands more innovation, more risk-taking. I mean, how is it possible that sonnets are still a thing? How medieval, how preposterous? We must do away with tradition and this irrational need to cling to the safety of rules. And we must do it before it's too late. Gentlemen, the time has come to save poetry. Are you going to sit idly by, or are you going to be active? Or are you going to watch it become sterilized into yet another bourgeois commodity? I know. I know my decision is taken. I'm serious!
Fighting words, my young brothers, Pierre. But do you have the couille to back them up?
I confess I'm not there yet. But I'm getting closer every day.
Oh, real?
Well, show us something then.
Why, yes, show us the app.
Read them the drunken boat.
As I was sailing along impassive rivers, I no longer felt the guiding grip of the crew. Shrieking savages had called upon their archers and seen to it that every man was pierced through. I never cared much for any of my sailors, nor for the loads of English cotton and Dutch wheat. Once my crew died, and along with it their clamour, the rivers let me sail wherever I pleased. In the wild and furious lapping of the sea tide, I ran off alone last winter, more deaf even than the minds of children. No peninsula's side ever suffered more triumphant a commotion. Tasting sweeter than sour apples due to kids, green water seeped into the pine boards of my hull. I was cleansed of the wine stains and the crew's vomit as the waves cast off the rudder, till and bridle. And since then I have bathed myself in the poetry of the sea, infused with celestial bodies, devouring the green heavens. Occasionally a wistful corpse would drift in the whirls and eddies. I know skies pierced by lightning and waterspouts, and currents and backwashes, and I know the night. Dawn, as exalted as a storm of birds flying out, and I have seen that which mankind thinks it holds in its sight. It goes on a bit. I don't know if you want to hear the rest.
You silenced Bonville!
That hasn't happened since 1866.
No, 1867.
It's that night at the Odeon.
No, it was at the Salon.
Gentlemen. Monsieur Rimbaud, I apologize. I thought you were a chopped up peasant brat with ideas above your station. I was wrong.
Bonville, is Paris ready for this?
Well, if not Paris, where? Of course, our friend is young. He still has a lot to learn. And he has come to the right place.
Man.
With our help, he will achieve great things.
May I?
Wait. What?
It's very clever, perhaps too much so. You're getting so caught up in using striking expressions that the idea gets a little confused.
I've no idea what you mean.
There are too many words but too little said. Not that you do not have a lot to say.
Well, at least that's slightly more specific than Monsieur de Bonvie's comments.
What do you mean?
He loved my drunken boat. And then he went on to say that there was room for improvement. He didn't know what he meant. He didn't mean it at all. The other day, he suggested changing the opening line.
Why?
Because it's the only line he could remember. That's why. And then he went on to give me a signed copy of his stupid little treatise on French versification. How dare he patronize me like that?
That book only came out this year. It was very kind of him to give you a free copy.
I don't need a rule, but French poetry doesn't need any more fucking rules. He's just like my teachers from Charleville. They can't stand the fact that I don't need them.
And I suppose I'm just another walking anachronism, butting in where I'm not needed.
I didn't say that.
Why did you come to Paris, Arthur? In poetic brotherhood. If you came all this way to make faces at the writers you meet, hide in your room and scribble self-satisfied little ready-made verses, then you may as well have stayed in Charleville.
Do you think it needs fewer adjectives?
Not necessarily.
Is it the syntax that's awkward?
Look, here, in the second verse.
Monsieur Rimbaud, is Paul in there with you?
Yes, darling, I was just looking over some poetry.
Yes, good. Are you coming out?
Yes, dear. Be a minute. I'm sorry, did I startle you? I thought you were looking a bit distracted.
I was just thinking about how good we were for each other in the beginning. How we helped each other grow.
You might have grown, but everything you gained was at my loss.
And now, a toast. To Mathilde, the most radiant young mother I ever saw.
I've always said it. The women in my family have been exceptionally strong, but Mathilde, to have recovered so soon at such a young age. I was,
not him. The boy is unaccustomed to wine.
Oh, Paul, don't be such a bore. How is he to grow accustomed?
Arthur's young. I don't wish to teach him bad ways.
I'm sorry, but if Mathilde, who is just 1 year older than I, is old enough to be a mother, surely I am old enough to drink wine.
Precisely. We do not like double standards in this household. Now, to Mathilde.
To Mathilde.
Mathilde.
You know, I was meaning to say I do like your new cravat. When I first saw it, I thought it was a little bit, original. But I must confess it has grown on me.
Thank you, madam. It's a delight to receive a compliment from a woman of such rare taste.
It matches his eyes.
I rather agree with Mathilde's comment.
Paul gave it to me.
Is that so, Verlaine? I must say, I never suspected you had such extravagant taste in neckwear.
It is rather gay, isn't it?
One might not expect it from such a morose-looking man, but Paul has often surprised me with his gaiety.
Paul and I often do. He may seem rather stiff at first, but he's really very sweet once one gets to know him better.
Stiffness can be a problem for many men of Paul's age. So tell me, Madame Verlaine, how did you get to know Paul Verlaine?
It was at the Chamois. My brother, Jean de Sylvie, is a musician and he was playing. I was a young girl, only 16.
A child! Marriage, however, was out of the question until she turned 18. Oh, but it was so romantic. How for half of 2 years he would come and visit with his little court, you know, but sheepishly under his arm. Don't you put your remember, darling?
Yes, he was damn sheepish.
And they were married in August. Ah, it was so beautiful, such a sunny day.
Damn hot.
Oh, and Teddy was so upset when he cut the cake. It was so pretty.
Damned expensive.
How charming.
What was it you said as we were leaving the church, Paul? Wasn't it something about the sun shining down on your life? My countrymen
I really can't recall.
On our wedding day, those verses you recited as we left the church.
I don't remember.
Paul, you must remember. The son, the accomplice of my joy.
Go on, Paul, I'd be so love to hear your poetry.
Now it's not the time.
Come on, Verlaine, spit it out, man.
The son, the accomplice of my...
What's wrong with you?
Enough!
I'm sorry, Paul. I did not mean to upset you. It doesn't matter if you don't remember.
Didn't he say so in the first place instead of all that stupid nonsense?
I'm sorry, I was feeling rather closed in on. Such matters I prefer to keep between Madame Verlaine and myself. I hope you all understand. Mathilde, you're okay. I haven't started you.
Yes, Madame, I understand. And there's really no need for anyone to worry about me. I feel quite recovered.
Indeed. Tilly, if you don't mind my saying so, motherhood really has left a sensuous glow. Your charms really have grown mountainous.
Really, Monsieur Rimbaud, you're too kind.
No, I understand why Paul chose you of all delicate flowers to pollinate and bear his fruit.
What poetry!
You started serving your beer rather than the name.
I say, what type of bees make milk?
What?
Are you feeling quite all right, young man?
Oh! A charade! I do love charades! What type of bees make...
Boobies!
She's a wrinkly old bitch, too.
What did you say?
Paul, say something.
I tried to kill my mother once.
And now, ladies, I think that it is well past all of our bedtimes.
Do not say such things. You did not really.
And so we shall retire and leave Mathilde's husband and his young friend to their most poetic and sophisticated discussions, which are far too elevated for the likes of us uninitiated. I shall speak to you in the morning, Verlaine.
Oh, mother. Indecency.
Paul, not true.
I'll speak to you in the morning, Mathilde.
Come on, Tilly.
Mathilde, please.
Come on, Tilly.
Did you really? Your own mother?
Twice, actually. Both times I was drunk and fell. I was in a bad place. Mathilde got me out of it.
Then you were truly living your life as an artist, not playing a respectable bourgeoisie in a starched white collar. Even if it was at the risk of disgrace, you used to chase beauty and freedom.
Beauty is a woman like Mathilde. Freedom is living life without the fear of the bailiffs coming to knock at your door.
You're utterly deluded, pretending to be charmed by this dainty little cage, but strip back the airs and graces and you'll see a man behind bars. It disgusts me. I, for one, would never be fooled by these comforts. I'd rather die on the street than betray my ideals for a life of ease.
Shut up!
All you ever do is talk, Paul. Sometimes I wonder what would happen if we...
What do you know about doing? What do you know about anything? Who are you to tell me how to live my life? You're just a petulant fucking child, you know that? You have no idea how much I want to ram this into you right now.
I wish you would. I wish just for once you would show me the man. The man I respected so much before I turned up and was confronted with the pathetic reality. Go on, do it.
Do it.
See, I might know nothing, but you have still lived more in one evening with me than in 2 years with your wife. That's why you wanted me, and that's what I came to Paris for. That's why you can't resist
me. I think it's time you went to bed.
Why do you always run away?
Because this is torture.
Come in.
Oh, Monsieur Rimbaud, I'm so sorry. I shall come back later.
No, stay. Please stay. How can I be of assistance?
Monsieur Rimbaud, you do realize that my father is having a word with Paul.
I gathered as much.
I'm afraid it is to do with your presence in the household.
Ah, the finest household I've ever been a part of. I feel quite at home here.
But, Monsieur Rimbaud, did you not realize that your behavior last night might have certain consequences?
Consequences? Is that what you call it around here? Consequences?
Is that post-cravat? Did he give it to you?
No, he gave it to me, all right.
Well, I suppose he was very upset last night.
He was. And giving it to me really seemed to cheer him up, though for the life of me, I couldn't say why. Well, stimulating this conversation has been, I need to take a shit. Is there anything else I can help you with?
You shall find out soon enough, I suppose. Good day to you, Monsieur Rimbaud.
Verlaine. I think we both know why I've called you in here today.
That is to say,
That boy is running riot in this house. And you stand there, all dull-eyed, mooning over him like a damned queer! I go away for a month's shooting, expecting you to keep the place shipshape. When I come back home, I find the place is being run by some Belgian ruffian who has the whole household bent over a table!
Silence!
Do you think I cannot see what is going on here? Never in my worst nightmares could I have imagined that this could happen to my own family. What kind of lily-livered herring chooses to occupy the furthest possible room from his wife's bedroom? Is there no blood in your veins, man? I saw that scrawny boy of yours wandering the corridors the other day, dressed in only his undershirt. Don't think I don't know what that means. That horny young devil has taken the cree from between your legs, and you stand there gawping like a fish!
I can explain.
Oh, can you? I very much doubt it. Unless your explanation is that he has been dipping his wick in another man's candle. Mathilde is a treasure. And treasures must be safeguarded, not left lying open to plunder by the first passing vagabond.
Mathilde! It is a treasure, but I assure you there is no risk of young Arthur dishonouring her.
Damned right there isn't! Because he is out! Today! And if you do not like it, you are out too! Back to whatever gutter Tilly found you in!
But surely, you told
me... Are you questioning my decision?
No,
Good. Then you may leave.
The little rat drew a knife on me after that piece I wrote in the paper.
Which one was that? I don't think I saw.
Mon vie, I'm hurt.
Well, you can't expect me to trawl through the back pages of every rag looking for your name, dear boy.
Life's too short, etc., etc.
It just mentioned that I'd seen our friend Paul skulking about outside the opera with a charming mademoiselle.
Oh. Thank you.
Anyway, the point is, he leapt across the dinner table with a pocket knife clenched between his teeth like some Congolese savage. Imagine!
Good heavens! What did you do?
What did I do? Well, I took the young ruffian by the scruff of the neck and dragged him into the hallway to give him a good spanking. A few of which, might I add, would have done him a world of good if administered earlier on in his development.
Congolese savage is the mot juste. I made the mistake of putting him up in my spare room after old man Moté kicked him out. He made a pigsty of the place. It was disgusting.
Did he soil the bed sheets? I doubt he'd recognize them after having grown up in some barn in Chamonix.
No doubt he would have soiled them had he not sold them.
I'm sorry, gentlemen, but if what you say is really true, how is he a member of the Cercle Zoutiste?
Charles Coe seems to have taken a shine to him. Although even he couldn't keep me, he couldn't stand keeping that animal in his workshop. He's put him up upstairs in the hotel. In fact, I think he's sharing a room with Cabanel.
Really? Charles Court? You don't think he's a pederast, do you? I mean, we all knew about Paul's little weakness, but I never thought of Charles as a shirt lifter.
No, I don't think it's anything like that. Rimbaud flattered him by taking an interest in his ridiculous contraptions. I think Ho is happy to have finally found someone ignorant enough to believe in his mad schemes.
Is he still trying to send signals to Venus with a giant mirror?
Even better, he's working on this phono doodad. A sound scoring device.
What's that?
Well, you speak into a horn and the vibration makes a needle inscribed patterns on a rotating wax cylinder.
And
that's it. He can't do anything with the cylinder. He wants to get the sound back. He says that's the trick.
It sounds almost as mad as his idea for photographs in color.
Gentlemen, I hope you come up with something better this time.
I almost fell asleep last week.
The fact you were drunk can't have helped.
I underestimated how dull you were going to be. I thought alcohol might enliven the experience. But last time was wrong. Perhaps I'll try hashish next time.
We're here to read poetry, not dabble in narcotics.
Merde, and you call yourself an artist. Surely you know poetry is all about the complete derangement of the senses. After all, what was it Baudelaire said? Always be...
Will you stop insulting the memory of my dear friend? Do you realize you soil his name every time you cite him out of context in a pathetic attempt to garner some sense of authority?
Gentlemen, come. If we are to be angry, let us thrust our rage upon a worthier candidate. I have just found a new poem by François Coupin, and I'm sure, Arthur, that you won't find it at all that dull.
Take your leave out of my book. I believe I've started quite a trend in pastiching this partial patriotic postcard drivel.
Arthur, please. I was only taking my time over. Besides, I've been fighting the Montparnasse poet since before you were in long trousers. I just wanted to come up with something that did justice to this particular individual.
It's good.
All right then, let's hear it.
O Aristis by François Coupé. The kitchen is well kept. The casserole drips on the hob. The maid waiting for her beloved prepares all the wine maturing, the salad. Her ruddy fingers with nails black at the tips find the worms between the green leaves. Someone is tapping at the window. This is what people are like after a big hammer. The wench offers him a teaspoonful for love. First a kiss, then up her ass he shoves his willy. To my mind, it seems far being silly.
Excellent, a masterpiece.
Thank you. I could not write something so shocking if I tried.
And that is why you are not a member of the Cercle des Outils. You're merely a passive spectator, laughing in a superior manner at things you would never dare undertake yourself.
But you're not seriously thinking that you're going to get this filth published. We've all grown accustomed to smut. After all, we've all spent time in the company of Mr. Rimbaud when he's not paid for it. But these are merely private jokes among friends. You cannot seriously print a poem about Sodom,
can't we? I think the public can take it. And if not, we'll have to find a new public.
Yes! That is the whole purpose of this venture. To mock the old sobriety that put her to bed for a century. And to shake things up.
Thank you, Mera. I knew you could be trusted to come to the defense of reason. And if I might be so bold, might the next poem be in honor of your latest collection?
Why, yes. I'd be honored indeed. Mm.
I'm sure we're all familiar with Monsieur Merat's collection, The Idol.
A collection which includes titles such as The Sonnet of the Forehead, The Sonnet of the Mouth, The Sonnet of the Teeth, The Sonnet of the Tongue, The Sonnet of the Eye,
etc., etc.
Well, it is tonight with much trepidation that we unveil a piece omitted from the collection. A most grievous omission. Rimbaud.
Thank you, Paul.
Wrinkled and brooding like a marigold, obsequiously sprawled through the moss it breeds, soaking wet from the love that gently leaks from the buttocks to the heart of its fold. Filaments like milky tears downwards roll, thus they weep under the cruel wind that heaves, carrying clots like autumn gutter leaves, they pour into the valley, black as coal. My lips have often kissed this plunger. My soul, envious of carnal hunger, lies in this bed of sighs from dusk till dawn. It is a profit on it, a sweet sonnet, a tube offering the best chocolate, the true promised land in moisture born.
You've really gone too far this time. It's all very well to insult Coupé, but Mira is one of our own.
Find a new public? Why don't you go read your poems to the animals in the barnyard in Chalaville where you were raised, honing your poetic talent by masturbating your quill.
You picked up a style, don't you?
Oh yes, we can all thank you, Monsieur Rimbaud, for bringing out the very best in all of us. Look at Paul, what positively glowing with happiness.
Oh, V, I beg of you, this has nothing
Gentlemen, please! Arthur was only having a laugh. If anyone should be offended, it is I. And I'm not. I can take a joke as well as anyone. No one made a fuss of Monsieur Rimbaud parodying Monsieur Verlaine last week.
Well, we all know Mademoiselle Rimbaud has a special influence.
Oh, big-bosomed goddess, you nourish fantasy. Indeed, all men who have a brain towards you run. The youth seeks you out and loves you in sum. The future lies in you like the fish in the sea. Gallic nation, all Greekness and Latinity. Her counties, her customs, her fortune, her soul. You hold them within you. Through you, France is made whole. Paris, and you keep it bound to your destiny. Oh, head, body shakes tip to toe in mayhem, and truly trembles and leaps when you say the word. You but smile, and the old herd is gay as a bird. They suffer your torment, so free, you free them. Oh, synthesis.
Thank you, quite enough of that dribble.
Listen here, young man, we've had quite enough of you.
Shut your cunt, Le Pelletier.
If you can't behave like a human being, you are no longer welcome here.
Behave like a human being? If what I see before me is the finest humanity has to offer, I'd rather be something else. Perhaps I'll be a dog.
His manners get jealous! What's got into the two of you? Idiots!
By the nose by
You're us. Starting to sound a lot like my father-in-law.
Charles, make him see sense.
Paul, you're a good friend. And I know you're a good man. Young Arthur has his chance, but you must admit he is rather aggressive. So, I do not think I can allow him to continue to be a member of our circle.
He always was too good for us.
Paul, I can't allow him to be published in our journal. He's hardly one of us.
Well, if Arthur Rimbaud's poems are not published, Paul Verlaine shan't be either.
Speak sense, man.
We wrote the Arseholes sonnet together. You can't separate us. We're like...
Two buttocks.
Au contraire, but an apt retort nonetheless. The choice is yours, Charles. Either you take both of us, or neither of us.
Then, we shall have to publish you both. But neither he, nor you, Paul, as long as you remain attached to him, may take part in these gatherings again.
I see. A compromise.
Paul, I'll forgive you the poem, but you can't seriously intend to abandon us, all just for the whims of your young friend.
Mr. Verlaine, you're one of the greatest poets of this century. I can't believe I'm living to see an author such as yourself abandon his career. His colleagues.
Man up, Verlaine. We're your friends, your first critics, your true admirers. That boy should be whipped, not worshipped.
Here, here, next time you take your belt off to him, you should use it to teach him a lesson.
I'll see you later, Charles.
Paul, tonight I had to start for a group. But you do know you will always find a friend in me.
Such a great poet.
Tis a pity of him.
One never knows. He might be back.
To last. I'm not going to continue doing this, helping you sneak in later tonight like a naughty teenager. I'm not some servant you tipped off. Damn it, Paul! I am your wife.
Not tonight, Mathilde. Please.
And don't you dare tell me you are working. I don't know what you are drinking or smoking tonight, but you reek. What kind of a man is our son going to grow up to be when this is the example you set him?
You're right, Mathilde. I want to be a better father. A better husband.
Don't touch me, pervert! How simple do you think me? People talk, Paul.
Arthur.
Yes, your precious Arthur. That animal that shits in people's beds and runs around naked. There is a word for men like you, Paul. Men who couldn't care less about their own child, but suddenly get very excited around other people's boys.
Shut up, that's enough!
I prayed for it not to be true.
Mathilde, please. I beg of you, these are all lies. People are jealous of Arthur, and so they invent reasons, sordid reasons, to justify my interest in him. But I swear to you,
Hold on.
I swear to you on our son. I only cherish his mind. The only relationship I have with Arthur is an intellectual one.
It's no use, Paul. Shall call me.
Who? Told you what?
Shall call.
What did he say?
He wasn't explicit about it, but he led me to understand that the rumors were not unfounded.
So you've been conniving with my friends?
I was desperate, Paul. I needed to know.
You stupid bitch!
Don't!
Don't you know where to hold your tongue? Never trust a woman. Silence! We were just fine, Arthur and I.
interfering. First your fucking father, then my so-called fucking friends, and now you!
Pushing it. No? Are you gonna tell me what's going on?
Shit!
Paul.
I beat Mathilde. I mean, I say I beat her. I tried to torture and kill her.
Is she...
She's fine. The family intervened before I could do any real damage.
Well, that's fortunate.
I tried to set her on fire.
Fire?
She made me so angry. She insulted this. That bitch of a wife, she insulted us. Love you. I love you so much. I had to kill her.
Paul, you're frightening me.
I'm frightening you. Isn't this what you wanted? Look at me and tell me this isn't what you wanted. Look at me, you brat.
Paul, I had my reservations when our friend Charles found me this unsolicited roommate. But Rambo here, contrary to his unsavory reputation, has turned out to be perfectly decent. I will have to put my foot down, however, if you intend to, stay the night.
I wouldn't be here if I had anywhere else to go. I genuinely don't.
Mathilde found out about Paul and I.
I'll speak to Charles in the morning. We'll figure something out.
At least it's all over now.
What is?
The pretending. Or bourgeois family man act you had going on.
And what, pray, makes you think it's an act?
Whoa. You know?
I'm a father, I'll have you know.
Christ. Paul, don't take out your midlife crisis on Ernest.
It's an identity crisis.
Where are you going now?
Nowhere. Look, can we just not talk about the Mottiers for 5 minutes?
Of course.
Have some more coffee.
Shit.
What?
I just realised, even if I did try and talk to Mathilde, I'd be arrested. Her father's probably put a restraining order on me by now.
Talk to her? Paul, you tried to torture and kill her. What could you possibly say to her?
that I was only trying to teach her a lesson, that I didn't mean to set her on fire.
So, you wanna go back?
I'm speaking hypothetically.
Yeah, I have to agree with Rambo here, but that seems like an unlikely outcome at this stage. Shall I fetch Claude?
Yes, please. What a mess. Bloody mess!
I have to figure out where you're sleeping. Tonight, I'll be a start.
Mathilde! She called me a pervert! A pervert! And
word.
She would have gone on to say worse things. I had to put a stop to that.
That's
kind of
the
language.
That's the word, Paul. For people like you and I. We're perverts. You better get used to it.
But it's not! At least the way I see it!
I'm afraid that doesn't really come into it. As far as the rest of the world's concerned, we are perverts, you and I. Isn't that right, Ernest?
What?
Paul and I are massive perverts.
Of course. I'm still getting over that asshole sonnet you read last night. Yeah, I don't think I'll be able to take a dump.
Oh, Ernest, you flatter us.
Right, anyway, I've got to go and see if I can find Paul. Expect he'll be up in his workshop by now.
Don't set anything on fire.
Will. Children.
I might have a bit of a lie down, if that's all right.
Well, you've gone coy all of a sudden.
What do you mean?
The door is wide open if you'd rather be somewhere else. Look, what was it? You wouldn't be here if you had anywhere else to go.
I'm not sure I follow.
Get your story straight. One second, I love you so much I had to kill her. The next, you're pining to run back there.
That's not how it is.
Isn't it? I'm good for buggering in the dark, but the second the light of day shines on our faces, you can't wait to get away from me.
Oh. Arthur, you...
Oh, I've heard that before. Arthur, when you want to have the last word. Ham, when you love me.
Arthur, you couldn't be further from the truth. Seeing you is the only thing that keeps me alive. I'm being erratic at the moment, I know, but you have to understand. I've just lost my family.
I left my family at the age of 16 to come and live with you, but I don't make a tragedy about it.
Oh. I forget how young you are, how far you've come. But believe me, there is nowhere else I'd rather be. My life has never been as full of beauty as by your side.
You really mean it?
Of course I do. Now, envy you and curse you, but I know you for who you truly are. I love you, and if I had to do it all over again, I would. I'd give it all up. You're my demon, my angel.
Liar! If I have to hear one more time a fairy tale about how you left a wife and kids for me.
It's not a fairy tale. That is how it happened.
Is it? Sit still and stop whining unless you want me to pull the trigger.
Arthur, please.
Oh, I've heard that before. Arthur, when you love me, Ham, when you want to have the last word.
I lost everything.
You had me!
Then we are agreed on the conditions.
Yes. Absolutely.
Good. My daughter could do far better than you, Verlaine. But, say what you will, separation is an ugly business, especially when there is a child involved.
How is Mathilde?
still shaken by your little bout of pyromania. Her hair is growing back. To be honest, for then, I wouldn't be here if her mother hadn't begged me.
Perhaps
I'm working on the assumption that the events of that night were entirely down to your state of intoxication.
Perhaps I could write to her?
Yes. That might help her with readjusting. Your son is well, by the way. He was in a fragile state for some weeks after being thrown to the floor. But he has recovered. Good day to you.
Smoke last night, Paul. I'm convinced I'm still hallucinating. I thought I saw Papa Moté in the lobby. What are you working on?
It's nothing. It's an idea for a piece. Arthur, sit. I have something I need to talk to you about.
I'm sitting.
We have no money.
Paul, and I thought you had some news for me. Come here, Papa Verlaine. Stop worrying so much.
I can't support you anymore.
That's really cute, but it's not you who's supporting us. It's our friends.
They're my friends. That's part of the problem.
Problem? What problem? Is this the problem right here? Huh? How about that? Am I holding the problem right now?
I can't speak like this.
Try.
It's over. I'm leaving you.
Say that again. Cat got your tongue? Or have you changed your mind?
Please.
Oh, you playing that crazy virgin again, Paul? Am I gonna have to bend you over the desk?
Get off me, you pervert! It's over! How many times do I need to say it's over? I'm going back to my family.
It was Moté, in the lobby. So you're really going back?
I have to do what's right for my family.
What do you do, strike some kind of deal?
Yes. I have to stop drinking and...
buggering.
Seeing you.
And you're going to take it? Seems like a pretty sweet deal, considering you tried to murder his grandson and his daughter.
I have to do what's right for them.
No, don't give me that. We both know the only thing that matters to you is your own comfort. You're not doing this for the wife you have fallen out of your mind with, and you're certainly not doing it for the infant you never once have in your arms.
Shut up!
What about that? I've seen this. You're writing again. Your best collection is the Italian poem. You're going to give that all up?
Thank you.
God, you're ugly. So you're really never going to see me again?
I can't control myself when I'm around you. It wouldn't be fair on Mathilde.
What about me? What am I going to do without you?
I've been thinking. Maybe it's time you went back to Charleville.
Just when I thought my adult life had begun, you sent me packing! Less than a year after I left, I had to go crawling back to my mother. As if it'd been another of my schoolboy escapades, as if my time with you meant nothing!
There was nowhere else for you to go!
I had a situation in Paris. I was making connections and building a reputation.
What reputation? Everyone hated you.
Perhaps, but at least I had their respect.
Please.
Bonvie and Malamé loved my poetry, even if they couldn't stand the sight of me. The truth of the matter is, you never cared about me or my writing. You just wanted me in Paris for easy access when you were feeling transgressive, and out of the way in Charleville when you were feeling pious.
I left her at the end, didn't I?
Left her? Who are you kidding? You just started thinking with your cock.
How is the writing coming along, Paul?
I've been reading mainly. To be honest, I've been so happy with George and Mathilde, I haven't really had time for that sort of thing.
You should have another baby.
Maman, please.
What? You don't want George to be lonely?
There's no hurry.
Maman, can you take Georges to Cologne, please? I think he needs washing.
How much longer do we,
sleep in the same bed again? I don't know, Paul. I'm not ready.
It's been 2 months! I don't even have wine with dinner!
You waited for 2 years before our marriage.
Mathilde, I miss you. I never thought I'd miss you coming home. You're so young and beautiful. I've been such a fool.
Most kind.
What is he doing here?
Oh, this is just a gesture.
I thought you were in Charleville.
I was, but who can resist the siren call of Paris?
If you'll excuse me, I have a migraine.
Oh, I'm very sorry to hear it, madam. I hope you feel better soon.
Claude, come with me. There's some things not fit for a child to see.
You're looking well, Mathilde. Lovely hair.
Mathilde, come and look at my cabinet. Mathilde, wait!
Well, she's certainly lost that air of virginal innocence.
What are you doing? I've
come to save you, Paul.
I told you I can't be around you anymore.
Then I'll make it quick. I'm leaving Paris tonight.
What? So soon?
I don't want to play games with you, Paul, so I'm giving you a simple choice. Come with me.
Where are you going?
Brussels first, and from there I don't know. Far away. Just came to tell you this. I'll be leaving on the Gare du Nord on the 9 o'clock train. If you want to come with me, meet me there. If not, I'll respect your decision. You'll never see me again.
I want you out!
Oh, Madame
Valet!
Don't,
my darling, blame me. I know what you are. Unfortunately for us, my husband is too weak to tell you what he really thinks of you. The fact is, we've had enough of you circling this family like a vulture. Don't you dare smile. My husband was a good man before he met you. I don't know what spell you put on him, but it's over. Now get out before I let my father know you're in his house. He'll be only too glad to feed some shame into you.
Tilly, dear, don't cheapen your tirade by bringing your father into it. I'm sure you're more than capable of teaching me a good lesson yourself. And afterwards, maybe I can repay the favor by teaching you some shameless. Paul, it's been a pleasure, as always. Think about my offer, won't you? Au revoir. Have a look.
The cheek! Marching back in here as if nothing ever happened.
What was he talking about?
Heaven knows, probably drunk or worse.
What offer? What were the two of you talking about?
Oh, that. It was some publisher. Sounded like a complete scam, if you ask me.
Why? Again?
No, I swear, he wanted help selling a manuscript.
One minute. That's all it takes. One minute for you to look into those eyes. And you're back to your old tricks. I can't believe it.
What tricks? Have you gone insane? We were just talking. He wasn't even here for 5 minutes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Should I have invited him to stay for supper? I'm sure we'd have all enjoyed reminiscing about the time together at the Hôtel des Étrangers.
Well, at least you gave me something to reminisce about. You won't even hold my hand, let alone spend a night with me.
My room. No.
What? Slumber as soft as death. I will spread my kisses without regret on your body, on that skin of olive. Nothing to me can equal this abyss, as your bed swallows my subsiding sobs. A powerful oblivion rains from above, and leafy falls from your kiss. To my fate, from now on my true destiny, I shall obey as if predestined. Obedient martyr, innocent convict. My very own fervor heightens my plight, and I will suck sweet hemlock's fatal laugh and leafy to better drown my disgust. From the charming tips of that ample breast, which always was devoid of any heart.
Who lived? Leafy.
Aren't you clever?
I think you should try writing in decasyllables. They're sort of bitter. I don't know why. Mm. I think it would really suit you. Mm. You gave me the uncensored edition of Baudelaire the first time we met.
And then you surpassed my gift
by giving me the uncensored edition of your arse.
I aim to please.
Aim to please, Arthur Rimbaud. That's an oxy thingy.
Oxymoron.
Oxymoron.
Paul?
What?
How about London?
London?
I've heard it's where all the rebel intellectuals go into exile.
Please, do you even speak any English?
A little. Come on, Papa Belen, it'll be fun.
I told you not to call me that, it's weird.
Come on, crazy virgin.
What would we even do there?
Ah, so this is the beauty of it. Apparently, you can make loads of money tutoring French for rich bourgeoisie parents. They want their children to speak it. They think it's aristocratic.
Well, I did tutor some Greek and Latin before I met Mathilde.
That's perfect. You can do that. Come on, I don't care where we go. I just want to go somewhere where no one knows us.
It would be nice to make a fresh start.
Il faut que j'aille. Il faut que tu ailles. Il faut que il aille. Il faut que nous allions. Il faut que vous alliez. Il faut qu'il aille.
No! 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 How many times do I need to tell you, do not pronounce the T. It's il faut.
Il faut que j'aille. Il faut que tu ailles. Il faut qu'il aille. Il faut que nous allions. Il faut que vous alliez. Il faut qu'il aille.
That's better. Now, can we have a liaison after nous and vous? Il faut que nous allions. Il faut que nous allions. And tu is pronounced tu, not tu.
Il faut que j'aille. Il faut que tu ailles. Il faut qu'il aille. Il faut que nous allions. Il faut que vous alliez. Il faut qu'il aille.
Marquise, si mon visage est quelque très un peu vieux, si vous n'avez vu qu'à mon âge, vous ne voudrez guère mieux. Le temps est plus belle chose, se plaît à faire un affront. Elle sera fanée vos roses, comme il a ridé mon front. Le même corps de planète règle nos jours et nos nuits. On m'a vu ce que vous êtes, vous serez ce que je suis. And she's meant to fall for that.
Well, yes, that is sort of the point.
I'm sorry, but in what universe would the lady be seduced by a man saying to her, I am old, and one day you will be old and wrinkly too.
Excellent translation, but you're missing the imagery. Note the concision of the lines. On a vu ce que vous êtes, vous savez ce que je suis.
We have seen what you are, you will be what I am.
Yes. Note how he plays with the tenses. Passé composé, présent de l'indicatif, futur simple, présent de l'indicatif.
Yes. Would you really say that to a lady? I would just think it rude.
You might think it rude, but it would certainly grab your attention, wouldn't it?
It comes from the back of your throat, like when you say E.
So, you were saying
a strange thing. So, essentially, yes. Think about it this way. This lady was in high demand. Every poet was writing to her, telling her how beautiful she was. Courtenay had to do something different. Carry on, you were reading very well.
Drinking is bad for you.
Yeah, well, your French is bad for me.
May I have some?
You may certainly not. Now, we're practicing the letter U.
If you don't, I'll tell my mother you drink it.
Please. Now, repeat
if
after
me. If you don't, I'll tell my mother you're a pederast.
What?
Mrs. Brown said she wouldn't let you teach her children because she heard that you're one.
Do you even know what it means?
No. But I guess I'll find out when I tell my mother Mrs. Brown is right.
Chasset Ross Nouvelle. Usure quelque credit. Vine passeres for bow. Content que je l'aurai dit. Pensez-y, belle marquise. Quacon grison fasse effroi. Il vaut bien qu'on le courtise quand il est fait comme moi. So he is saying, in posterity, people only think you beautiful because I say so. So even though I am not handsome, you should still try to please me because I'm a great poet.
Again, you go straight to the essential, but yes, you are correct.
How incredibly conceited!
What?
What makes them think you're so important?
Oh, this is Corneille we're talking about.
Didn't you say last week that Racine was a better playwright?
I did, but that's just a matter of my taste. Corneille is at least as great an author as Racine.
Well, it's conceited anyway, because he thought of himself as a great author.
But don't you find it interesting how the poem begins with human time, as marked by the turning of the planets? Le même corps de planète règle nos jours et nos nuits. The movement we all share. And then he introduces the idea of the time of poetry, which lives on through the generations and tells a story which never dies. It's the idea of a different reality on the pages of literature. Et dans mille ans faire croire ce qu'il me plaira de vue. What?
He's saying, I will spread lies about you, and people will believe me because I'm famous. So, if you do not want to be... This is not amusing at all! This is a man being rude, conceited, and losing his reputation as a writer to have his way!
Yes, you are right, of course, you're correct. You just reminded me of my sisters, just then.
You have sisters?
Vitalie and Isabella.
How old are they?
About your age. I haven't seen them in a while. They're in France. Anyway, that's enough for today.
Are you going to the British Library?
Yeah, I'm working on my manuscript.
May I ask what it's about?
It's sort of autobiographical. I'm neither poetry nor prose. I'm thinking of calling it Deux années en enfer.
2 years in hell? It's a bit dramatic, isn't it?
You think?
Well, I'm not an expert, but 2 years is a long time.
How about 1 year in hell?
Do you need years or months? I mean, if hell is a metaphor, it seems a bit odd to put a date on it.
a season in hell.
Well, I still think the whole hell thing is a bit of an exaggeration. I mean, wouldn't purgatory be a bit closer to reality?
That's quite enough for you. All I can say is with that attitude, at least you're any good at French.
I mean, I have to do something right to keep you coming back. Goodbye, Monsieur Rambo.
You're late. It's cold. Where were you?
British Library.
I thought you were coming home straight after teaching. I'd appreciate it if I knew you were staying out. I'd have made other plans.
Well, maybe you should next time.
That's not the point. The point is you should tell me when you're staying out.
The crazy virgin thing was cute at the beginning, but it's getting a bit tiring now.
You do realise that's the food I bought and prepared for you that you're eating?
Yes, and I'm very grateful. But I've said I was at the BL, so can we drop the topic?
How do I know you were really at the British Library?
Christ, if you didn't have a dick, I'd assume you're on your period.
Are you sleeping with her?
Sit down and shut up, Paul. You don't want to fight with me.
I have a right to know. Seriously.
I can't even go to work without you concocting some fucked up little scenario.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's all in my head. You've never done anything wrong. Your chastity and saintlyhood are an example to us all.
Why can't you trust me? You just want to keep me in a cage.
Because I see the way women look at you. They're all gagging for your attention, and you love it! You're a whore! And you would jump at the first opportunity!
So now you're an expert on women's affections? What a shame I didn't save your pathetic excuse for a marriage!
Don't use Mathilde against me! You always do this! Don't think I don't know that's what you're doing! I'm not as thick as you might imagine!
Don't you dare tell me what I do and don't imagine!
Don't you dare tell me there's nothing going on!
What's going on?
You're always late when you come home from teaching that girl.
You're always late when you come home from the priest. Yes, I know your little secret. So don't throw those crazy accusations at me.
So what if I like to have a confession now and again?
You're pathetic!
So now that's out in the open, tell me. Has the old man got bored of your let me chase, but not yet routine? Do you spice it up with some heartfelt regret, throwing some cliches about fatherhood?
Shut up!
Well, at least it saves me from having to hear about your undying love for Mathilde.
Looks like I spoke too soon. You are mine, you who are young and frenzied as France. How heartwarming. Looks like I was right about decasyllables too, they really suit you.
I'm right about you too!
Yeah, I can see that. Let me roll my head upon your young breast, and let me sleep a while since I am now dismissed. So very derivative, but let's leave that for now. This more than makes up for the shit you pulled in Brussels. Planning to leave with Mathilde the night we were planning to leave for London. But this poetry, this more than makes up for it. I would leave anything for a man who writes about my young breast.
I'm sorry, I overreacted.
I'm starting to get tired of you, Valen.
Is there anything else I can get you to eat?
Does it ever strike you as odd that you should be the unfaithful one? I mean, the greasy and dishevelled look isn't normally considered an attractive attribute.
I can't help but feel guilty about what I did to Mathilde.
With you, huh? I mean, let's look at this objectively. You're hideous beyond your years. Your cowardice is astonishing. I mean, sure, you were once a great poet, but you're now composing these pathetic odes to wife and nation. Why don't you hang out with old Francois Coupé?
Ram, please,
but
stop!
I've heard that before.
I love you.
Ram, I love you. Mathilde, I love you. Ram, you're beautiful. Mathilde, you're beautiful. Ram, I'd do anything
for you. What do you want from me?
What a hideous question. What could anyone want from you?
I'll do anything. You can punch me. Is that what you want? Do what you want to me.
Don't be ridiculous. Rather, tell me what this is.
It's a toy.
I can see that. But since there are no children residing at this address, I wonder what it's for.
It's for decoration. I like to have it on my desk while I'm working.
Can I have it?
Why?
Will you give it to me?
What are you going to do with it?
That's none of your business. But considering the display you just put on, accusing me of hideous acts of betrayal and throwing punches like a savage, it might be a considerate gesture.
If that's what you really want.
Thank you, Paul. Do you love me, Paul?
That's a silly question. I adore you. Wow, you know I do.
Then go get me a drink. I'm thirsty.
Of course. What are you doing?
I got bored. Look at you, you're pathetic. Get my boots off. Where are you going now? Going to buy a new toy for baby George. Oi, crazy virgin, I'm talking to you. Paul? Paul, where are you going with all that money?
3rd of July, 1873, at sea. My friend, I do not know if you'll be in London when this reaches you, but I just wanted you to know that you must understand that in the end I absolutely had to leave. That this violent lifestyle, with all its unjustified scenes of your fantasy, could fuck me no longer. Only because I loved you immensely. On ne soit qu'il pense. I also wanted to confirm that if in 3 days I'm not back with my wife and under perfect conditions, I will top myself. 3 nights in a hotel, a revolver, these things do not come cheap. Hence my stinginess when I left. You should forgive me. If, as is likely, I commit this last idiotic act, at least I shall go like a good idiot. And my last thought will be for you, my friend. You who was calling my name from the pier and whom I did not want to go back to because I had to croak. Finally. Do you want me to send you kisses as I snuff it? Your poor Verlaine. We shall not see each other again in any case. If my wife comes, you will have my address and I hope you are right. Until then, 3 days, no more, no less, Brussels, general delivery, in my name.
Fourth of July, 1873, London. Come back. Dear friend, only friend, come back, I swear, I will be good. I was moody with you. It was a joke I convinced myself to play. I became stubborn and I regret it more than can be said. Come back and all will be forgotten. been 2 days and I've not stopped crying. I beg you. It's for your own good, actually. If you come back now, you will find all of your things. Surely you know now there was nothing true in our discussion, in that awful moment. But you, when I was waving at you and calling at you from the pier, why did you not come back? Why did you not get off the ship? We'd lived together for 2 years to reach that point. What will you do now? If you won't come back, would you like me to come to where you are? Yes, I was in the wrong. You won't forget me, will you? No, you cannot forget me. I still have you here. Write to your dear friend and let me know. Must we no longer live together? Be brave. Answer quickly. I cannot stay here any longer. Listen only to your good heart. Quick. Should I join you? Yours for all my life. Arthur Rimbaud. 5th of July, 1873. Dear friend, I received your letter marked at sea. You are in the wrong this time. You are completely in the wrong. Do you really think your life will be better with people other than me? Think about it. Certainly not. It is with me alone that you can be free. And since I promise to be very kind to you in the future, since I deplore my past wrongdoings, and since my mind is clear and I care for you, if you do not come back, you commit a crime. And will regret it for years with the loss of any freedom and displeasures far more atrocious than anything you have experienced thus far. Think again of what you were before you met me. As for myself, I'm not going back to my mother. I'm coming to Paris. I hope to leave by Monday night. Of course, if your wife does join you, I won't compromise your situation by writing. I will never write again. The only true word. The only true word is this. Come back. If you read this, show some courage and a sincerity of spirit. Otherwise, I pity you. But I love you. Send you kisses, and we will see each other again. Rimbaud. Until Monday night or Tuesday noon, if and only if you want to see me.
And this one's for you, Mathilde.
Thank you, but I shan't be reading this.
Splendid, splendid.
What is it?
Papa, will you throw it away, please?
It's from your husband, isn't it?
Mama, what are you doing? You have no right going through my private correspondence. Give it back.
If you're not going to read it, someone else has to.
Shouldn't it be Mathilde's decision?
He's her husband. We're not going to ignore the man.
But precisely. He's her husband. Shouldn't this be between the two of them?
Carl is no longer my husband. How many times do I have to repeat this to you? We are divorced. Stop calling him that.
I'm sorry, Tilly, but please understand this divorce business. It takes some getting used to. As far as your mother and I are concerned, marriage is for life. No matter how long you have been separated. I mean divorced.
Mama?
He's going to kill himself.
But what in God's name?
The letter! It says he will kill himself if you don't do something! Please, Mathilde, you must do something!
That is quite enough! Mathilde has made it clear that she does not wish to read this letter.
But he will die! Mathilde, please, please, I beg of you, his life is in your hands, my dear.
Will you stop terrifying her?
Terrifying her? Read it! It's written here!
It is none of our business.
And how can you?
He's no longer her husband. He's no longer our son-in-law. Frankly, I'm growing tired of your insistence on protecting the miserable wretch. He has only ever brought Mathilde pain and sorrow. If he were to top himself, good riddance is what I would say.
But my dear, surely you cannot be wishing death on the man.
And why not? It would make young George's life easier for a start. When he grows old enough to wonder why he has no father, at least we can say that he is dead. Better an orphan than the son of a pederast.
You not speak to your daughter like that! Apologize now!
You won't do it.
What was that, sweetheart?
You won't do it. It's just blackmail. Doesn't need me to save him. He just wants to come home and thinks that this will make me pity him enough to take him back.
But my dear, how can you be sure? Living with that boy, all the drugs and the alcohol, people like that do terrible things.
Mother, this is Paul we're talking about. He's not mad. Just lonely. Death is too definite. Suicide means committing to a choice. It's the one irreversible act. That's why I know he won't do it.
My dear, if you do not help him, you will forever be your husband's murderer!
Thank you for your letter. It meant a lot.
Well, you left quite suddenly. I didn't get a chance to say I really liked your last poem.
Which one?
Tears are falling in my heart as rain falls on the city. What is this sadness which starts slowly seeping into my heart? We're usually afraid of being simple, but this one really worked.
I don't think she's going to come.
Me neither.
Really? You don't? In that case, I guess this is goodbye.
Oh, you don't have to do this.
What was it you said in London? A coward beyond belief.
Oh, I didn't mean that.
Yes, you did.
Even if I did, you're not going to kill yourself to prove a point, are you? That would be...
pathetic.
I was going to say idiotic.
Do you think she still loves me?
She's your wife. What do you want me to say?
I think I still love her. Do you think I still love her?
That's for you and her.
You're the one getting jealous.
Please. I was just angry at you about the other stuff. I know you love me.
Kiss me properly.
Christ, Valen, so no need a gun in your hands all the time?
You always have an ulterior motive. I'm a fool for thinking I meant anything to you.
I'd come all this way if I didn't love you.
I'm the one in charge here. This is my room, my gun, my plan.
Fine.
Where do you think you're going?
come. Well, clearly my presence has interrupted your hitherto finely executed plan.
I did not give you permission to leave.
Now I need your permission.
Shut up, I need to concentrate.
I came because I thought I could help you. Clearly I was wrong, so just let me leave.
Take off your clothes.
What?
I want to look at you when I go.
Oh, you'll not go.
What?
Darling, please.
You think I'm not man enough? Stand back! Don't touch me. Not for once in your life. Do as you're told.
I can't let you do this. What about your son? Don't you want to see him grow up?
Both know I'll never see George again. What difference could it make?
Mathilde might change her mind.
How could that ever happen?
With time. If you really left me, if I was out of the picture, she might.
So now you want me to leave you?
I just want you to be happy.
Hurry up with the shoes.
Do you believe me when I say I love you?
Take off your shirt.
Do you believe me, Paul?
Yes.
And my letter? Do you believe my letter? Even if you do leave me, I will always be yours. For all my life.
Me too, huh? For all my life.